morning. It's good to be here today. This is a working session, so I would encourage you to get comfortable. We've got a lot of stuff to go over. Before I start, I want to recognize my family. There's nothing more important than family to me. My lovely wife, Terry, and daughter, Paige, are here witnessing my performance today and will be my toughest critics. So good morning again. First, let me apologize if my energy level's not 100% this morning. I was up all night trying to navigate healthcare.gov. I don't think I have a new health insurance policy quite yet, but I did manage to watch all five Die Hard movies while I was entering my personal information and hitting the reload button on my computer countless times. It was amazing how Bruce Willis manages to prevail every time against insurmountable odds. Bullets, explosions, blows to the heads, they just don't faze him. He refuses to lose. Unfortunately, it's a lot harder to win in the real world than it is in the movies. Harder for individuals, companies, cities, and states. But there are common traits all winners have, traits that fall into two categories, hard traits and soft traits. And Bruce Willis certainly is a strong guy, blessed with enough physical prowess to get him out of most jams. And he's typically armed with impressive firepower, technology. Those are his hard assets. But Bruce is always outgunned. And by the end of each Die Hard movie, it comes down to Bruce, bleeding, bruised, left only with his courage and absolute will to win. These are what I call his soft assets. And by the end of the fifth Die Hard movie, it becomes clearer that those characteristics are far more important in determining the outcome. So this morning, I'd like to focus on Michigan's hard and soft assets. And to answer the question Doug Rothwell has asked me to address, is being competitive enough to win? And I promise my speech won't take as long as the Die Hard movie or how long it takes to register for health insurance. So let's start with some history. The rise of the United States to superpower status came over the last century, about and as a result of the creation of the world's largest middle class. We had a built-in eternal market that was second to none and could also penetrate the markets abroad. We built everything and anything you could think of for decades. We owned the ingredients that had never existed in the world simultaneously. A middle class with a great opportunity for a great education and good government. No country in the world ever had both. And you could make a case that in the mid-20th century, no city had more of what made the United States great than Detroit. In 1953, Japan was number 29 in the world GDP. The United States was number one. Michigan held the fifth highest per capita income in the country. Today, Michigan has tumbled to 38th. The United States has slipped to number 14, and Japan has nearly closed the gap and is now number 16. And the Japanese story can be repeated by another 13 countries who have since passed the United States. So you might ask, what's changed? Today's world is borderless, with a fast-growing middle class that values education, hard work, and that elusive sacrifice for the benefit of their children. And like Bruce Willis, they want to win. There is competition at every turn, around every corner, in the being of every single person, competition for what we have. There isn't a country where Walbridge works, where everyday workers don't want to live in America or have what America has. This is true in South Korea, Mexico, Brazil, China, and anywhere else in the world you care to think of. The United States shepherded in the global juggernaut of individual initiative, innovation, hard work, and the freedom to pursue one's dreams. Today, everything is mobile. People, capital, equipment, ideas, and technology. The only barrier to success in the world today is the culture of the area itself. It's culture that makes the difference. So I wonder if Michigan has the right culture to win on this fiercely competitive and increasingly fragile global playing field. So what are the ingredients, the assets needed to win that extra 500,000 jobs that Michigans need so desperately? I consider Michigan's hard assets to be the metrics that define the cost of doing business in our state and how we rank statistically with others. You all know the things that corporations like to measure, metrics like GDP, per capita income, taxes, energy cost, regulation, and incentives. So you might ask, how are we doing? On paper, as they say, we're looking more and more competitive every day. The Snyder administration has delivered on its promises to lower costs for business. In just 3 years, governor and the legislature have led initiatives that have made Michigan the second state in the nation to go to freedom to work, eliminated the Michigan business tax, and replaced it with a much more predictable income tax, decreased workers' compensation premiums by over 7%, erased the unemployment trust fund $3.9 billion debt, thus eliminating the tax penalty. This all results in Michigan's corporate tax climate rising from second worst in the nation to seventh best. And Michigan is also a top 10 state for R&D and patent activity and growing in venture capital. Doug will go into these in much more detail following my remarks. The Anderson Economic Group has presented some interesting data concerning job growth in Michigan from 2009 to 2012. Their analysis reveals that the United States recovery has relied significantly on an increase in services and natural resources. But here in Michigan, 35% of all new jobs have been in manufacturing, and that's not a bad distinction and can serve us very well. So you might ask the question, if we've done so well in repositioning Michigan from a cost-to-business basis, if we look so competitive on paper, why haven't we been more competitive in attracting these jobs we need and taking unemployment to full employment? In business, we put a lot of emphasis on metrics, but there's a danger that hard metrics don't always tell the right story. I want you to recognize this. Albert Einstein once said, "Everything that can be counted does not necessarily count. Everything that counts cannot necessarily be counted." Which now takes us to what I call soft assets, where the picture is much more challenging. Unfortunately, despite the progress Michigan has made since 2010, it's still laden with a national and international reputation that has been decades in the making, one of constant turmoil and conflict. Michigan is competitive on paper, but that isn't enough. We are in need of a cultural makeover. A good analogy would be sports teams. They offer excellent examples of what I'm talking about. They compete in the era of free agency and can buy in the open market the very best players baseball has to offer. These players have great stats, great metrics. New York Yankees have the highest payroll in baseball, a staggering $230 million per year. They're awesome on paper, but didn't make the playoffs this year. They were good, but not good enough. On the other hand, the Pittsburgh Pirates, who have one of the lowest payrolls in baseball, at $68 million per year, had a better record than the Yankees, and made the playoffs. They had heart. They had better soft assets such as passion, strategy, coaching, and team in capital letters. All very subjective. All about people. All about culture. It's all about what's in your heart. And in Hollywood and the real world, it does make all the difference. Now, I want to mention a couple of personal stories that illustrate my point even further. Walbridge has been chasing the opportunity to build large-scale infrastructure and complex manufacturing facilities on a global scale for almost 100 years. It gives us a unique position to see how decisions are made, jobs are created, and where they're located. After receiving a contract to build a new auto assembly plant in the south of the United States for a foreign OEM, I decided to visit their overseas headquarters to express our gratitude. During this meeting, I asked a simple question of them. Why did you select the South over Michigan? Their answer stunned me. It was one word. It was cohesion. Not cost, I asked. After all, Walbridge had participated in pricing the plant for three separate locations, and the cost differential was less than 5%. And Michigan had put forth the best incentive package. Surely that would have won it. It didn't. Back to cohesion. The story went that Michigan was too confrontational to suit their needs. After an exhaustive internal study, the certainty that our community would stand behind the plant should the global competitive environment change wasn't there. The investment was approaching $2 billion and would take 10 years for a return to mature. Too long to take a chance. They needed to be in a state that understood all of this and would work as a team to help keep them competitive. They were incredibly knowledgeable about all the labor strife that had played out in Michigan over 50 years. They wanted union cooperation, not union confrontation. They mentioned the race riots in the 20s, the 40s, and finally the big one in 1967. How would that play out given the strong segregation in southeastern Michigan? They mentioned the constant political battles in Lansing between Democrats and Republicans. I said enough. I got the picture. I learned something similar in 2009. Walbridge had built 10 major plant facilities for Toyota in three countries plus its Ann Arbor Technical Center. One day during a flight back to the United States from Japan, I asked the question of my counterpart. What were the main criteria used in choosing a particular geographic location? Answer, not cost. Work ethic of the region. And the notion that hard work is intrinsically virtuous and worthy of reward. Wow, I said to myself, virtuous? The word was almost cult-like. Reminds me of that good old-fashioned American virtue from the 1950s. You know, the one where sheer effort enables those with nothing to surpass those with privilege and position. The second criteria, harmony of the people, all the people. As globalization progresses, our society faces an increasing number of challenges on a global scale that are diverse in nature, traverse various aspects of society, the economy, and the global environment. These issues are too intricately entwined by multiple factors to be addressed by the public sector alone, which includes national governments, international organizations, and the social sector. Against this backdrop, expectations are rising for businesses that possess a wide range of global resources to contribute to the solving of these complicated social concerns. The third criteria, availability of trainable, skilled workers. Education counts, and lots of it, and continuous. It's where they come up with the word continuous improvement. They take a very planned and long-term approach to hiring new employees. They hire for life, and it's very important to hire the right employee with values that are in alignment with a company's overall culture. They look carefully at a candidate's personality, values, ability to learn, ability to teach, and many other attributes that are vital to the success of not only the company, but of the actual employee themselves. They hire employees based on their values and their potential. They understand that low-skilled jobs requiring low educational attainment are being eliminated at an alarming rate. Today's jobless recovery is aimed directly at those individuals. Just look at the unemployment rates. If you have less than a high school education, the national unemployment rate is 12.5%. If you have a high school education, it's 8.3%. College, 4.5%. Professional and PhD, 2.1%, which is essentially full employment. Other states are getting this message. Is Michigan? 1 month ago, Walbridge broke ground on a new $1 billion pipe mill in Shreveport, Louisiana. The entire state was there, including the governor, the mayor, many political officials from both sides of the aisle. I sat next to the Undersecretary of Commerce. He taught me a lesson, too. He heads the state's efforts to secure jobs. His job title and description: Undersecretary, State Economic Competitiveness. His department measures the state's competitiveness against its major rivals. He has a staff of 6 senior analysts that scour data from other states and countries. It's nonpartisan. It serves 2 important purposes. 1, it helps sell the state. But more importantly, it helps to educate the public and politicians concerning changes needed to better position the state to win. Together, the cohesiveness of that community and the desire to win was evangelical in nature. You could feel it, you could taste it. And Louisiana is not alone. South Carolina has identified our business, the auto business, as a target industry. They've assembled a group of business chambers, political and governmental officials, and regularly meet to develop comprehensive strategies and review results. They're very hard on themselves. One effective initiative is an annual trade mission to Europe. This was not a politically motivated public relations trip. While those are important to establish high-level contacts amongst top officials, the South Carolina mission is what it's intended to identify and support foreign companies interested in locating to the United States, and preferably South Carolina. They visited these targeted companies on a regular basis, providing resources, funding to assist in the collection and development of important cost and operational data. This is intended to show the competitive advantage of locating in South Carolina. These trips also begin to develop strong interpersonal relationships with a real decision maker. It's these relationships that paid tremendous dividends during the actual competitive phase. It's often when the seeds of success are planted. This effort is funded jointly by business and the state economic development arm. It's transparent and not subject to partisan attack. It's another example of great team effort. No press, no fanfare, just results. The governor and the MEDC have appointed a new auto czar, which is a great beginning at changing the way we approach this issue. So just like the survival of Bruce Willis through 5 Die Hard films, the answer to Michigan's long-term success comes down to strengthening our soft assets, making sure our culture is up to the challenge of a fiercely competitive global business environment, and getting our reputation in line with our improved business climate. We've made a lot of progress getting taxes and spending more in line, but now we need to start investing in our people at all ages, at all levels, and that starts with education. There's an old Chinese proverb that says, if you want 1 year of prosperity, grow grain. If you want 10 years of prosperity, grow trees. If you want 100 years of prosperity, grow people. And Michigan is very fortunate to have plenty of hardworking, smart, aggressive, educated, committed, and trustworthy people. My company is able to compete all across the globe with those assets. Michigan is very, very rich in human capital. This precious soft asset is really the foundation of the wealth of our state and our key to the future. So what's holding us back from changing the culture here in Michigan? What's stopping us from creating that culture, along with looking good on paper, will allow us to compete with anyone or anything? It's conflict. It's focusing on internal competition instead of external competition. It's partisanship at its worst. So I ask you, are the ideological, political, and/or strategic interests of labor and management, Democrats and Republicans, blacks and whites, so misaligned that we can't solve this problem? History has shown that when ideological interests are confronted with strategic interests, the strategic always prevailed. Has that changed now in our state? The strategic interest of this state must be to provide the best employment opportunities for its citizens and thus create the most competitive economic landscape possible. Are we misaligned on this? Are we in an ideological conflict where there can be no truce? If so, who is prepared to risk the loss of another million jobs needed to secure the futures of our generations to come, as we did from 2000 to 2008, when we sat idly by? When you eliminate compromise, political stalemate ensues. And that, my friends, is where we are at today, and the results are before us. No truce, no draw, no solution. Only victory or defeat, which is holding us back from our potential. So we would be wise to seek a solution that will return Michigan to the economic juggernaut it was five decades ago. This is the obligation we have to the future. So Doug, I hope I've answered your question better than healthcare.gov answered my questions last night about health insurance. Just being competitive is not good enough to win. We need to develop better ways to bring us together as a team. We need to sell Michigan together. We need to stop the conflict. We need to embrace citizenship over partisanship. We need to be cohesive as a state again. That's a culture built to win. Just ask Bruce Willis, because like Michigan, he knows how to die hard. Thank you for your attention. It was a pleasure and an honor to be before you today.